I got mine too. Hold on. That's my thought of the week. Obsessed.
Like, you looked at me and I was like, wait, that ain't coming to my phone.
Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 LPFM Lexington. In addition to listening to us on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or if you are out of the Lexington area, you can download the WLXU app on your smartphone device. Amber Turner is in the studio with me. I get a little tongue-tied saying the intro. It becomes very competitive, or very repetitive every single week having to say the same thing.
I enjoy it, though.
I do, too. You got to get it out there. You got to let people know that we are in other places other than just the radio.
Other than just the Facebook Live.
You can download the app. Download the app anywhere in the country and listen to this nonsense, because we try to bring you...
Whoa. What are you talking nonsense?
Let's be honest with you. Let me be honest with everybody. It's a bunch of nonsense, but it's good nonsense. Amber, this is the last show that we're doing of the summer. Don't get it confused that this is the last show we're doing, but next week when we come in here to the studio, it's going to be fall.
I just hope that the temperature comes down.
I'm ready
for actual, like, fall weather.
I like fall weather, but I dread the time change when it gets dark really early.
It's already starting to do that.
It started to do that, and it's really stressing me out because, Amber, I don't know if you've ever had this happen to you before, but my headlights went out. But let me be specific with what I'm talking about, my headlights going out. The low beams are not working.
So your normal, like, driving lights aren't working.
The normal driving lights aren't working. You know, when you're driving in your car, you typically drive on low beam because you don't want to bright light anybody.
Yeah.
But my brights, they work. So for the last...
So you're that guy.
So for the last 3 or 4 days, I've been riding around Lexington, bright lighting everybody.
I need to know how this is working out for you.
It's not working out good at all. Like, not only is it stressing me out because I don't want to get pulled over by blinding a cop, but I don't want to get killed either, because people are really, really mean to people who get to the person who bright lights them. And I'm telling you, I'm just driving at night with my brights on, and I can't help it, but people are rolling down their window, flipping me off, cussing.
Well, are you going, like, long distances, or are you just staying, like, in town, or, like...
So, I got to drive to West Virginia, because that's where I teach, but
you drove all the way to West Virginia With your high beams on?
With the high beams on. I went all the way on the Melton Parkway.
You made me nervous already just talking about
on the Melton Parkway, driving with my brights on, and people do not like that.
No.
I mean, and there's no way you can avoid getting people upset at you because you're driving behind people, you're bright lighting them, and people are so dramatic. They're like, they're holding their hands up in front of their eyes.
Like,
and
the rays of the sun are like coming through.
Is about to blind them. Yeah. And I'm like, would you quit it? I mean, and people keep going, ticka, 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 trying to.
Oh, flipping them on and off.
Flipping the lights on and off, trying to let me know, hey, your bright lights are on. And I'm like, I know, I don't have no lights.
Now, how are you supposed to convey that to them, though? How are they supposed to know?
You can't. You just kind of gotta, you really just kind of gotta take it. But it stresses me out. So, in Lexington, if you're driving around and you see somebody with the brights on, chances are it could be me. So just give me a break.
So go ahead and give him the bird again.
Yeah, don't give me the bird. But if it's not me and you see somebody with their brights on, give them the benefit of the doubt that they don't have them on purpose. They might not have any low beam lights to have.
You know, I've never had this happen to me, but you are the second person that I've talked about this happening with, like, within the last year. I've got a girlfriend. Guess they were going to the airport at, like, 5 o'clock in the morning, and all she could drive on was just her high beams. And I just remember her explaining when she came back from her vacation, like, literally how aggressive people got. And she was like, dude, I have my kid in the car.
People get so mad.
She used that word aggressive.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it.
And, you know, I thought about it, but think about all the times that, like, you're driving and, like, you know, you've ridden with me a lot. Somebody cuts me off, what's the first thing I do? I throw that hand up and that finger, ooh, right in the air.
So I do plan on getting that fixed ASAP. It's just, it's more than just my lights being out. I don't want to get into it, but I have a foreign car. I don't recommend anybody to ever get a foreign car. If you're going to buy a car, get a Chevy, Ford, something like that. Something American made. Don't get a foreign car because they're really expensive to work on. And I went to get the bulbs placed before, and they're like, dude, you have an electrical issue with your car. Because my phone don't even charge my car.
Oh, wow.
But I plan on getting that fixed. Amber, it's been a great week. This past weekend, we attended Scarefest in Lexington.
We did.
Scarefest in itself is a cool event. It is a place that you can go, and it's an intimate setting to where you can meet the people that you grew up watching, whether it be TV or movies, from the horror film industry.
Yep, from paranormal.
From paranormal. It's great. And there was a few people that were there that I don't know why they were there, because they had nothing to do with horror movies or horror TV shows. Like, for instance, the Twisted Sister, Dee Snider.
We met Dee Wallace.
We did meet Dee Wallace.
Not this year.
Last year, the mom from Cujo.
We met her, I think, 2012.
The mom from E.T. and the mom from Cujo.
And the mom from Cujo.
But Twisted Sister,
Dee Snider,
he was there. He had nothing to do with horror films, did he?
Well, I think he was in, like, terrible, and I'm so sorry, Dee Snider, a terrible movie in, like, the mid-90s that was considered of the horror genre. I think the only horror was that it was just so bad.
Well, it was cool. We had a purpose for going to Scarefest. If you guys attended Scarefest, you might have met the same person we did. I met one of my top three favorite wrestlers of all time, Mick Foley. Absolutely the nicest human being, I believe, that's on this planet. Too nice to be a celebrity. How cool was that experience?
It was probably, you know, and I've went to a lot of conventions over the years. You know, I've got a parade of pictures and autographs. And I met some really nice people, met some not nice people. But, you know, I have a method to my madness. I made sure that we were there 15 hours early than what we needed to be. But we had to wait a little bit, so I was getting a little nervous because I was like, man, how's this meeting going to go? Because we're waiting. You know, we were waiting.
Oh, and when you wait, that anticipation is what's so scary. Because I'm sitting there, I'm waiting to meet Mick Foley, and I have never really had a good conversation besides Kane.
Yes.
Besides Kane, with one of my top five favorite wrestlers, and Mick Foley is in there. And I started to get really extremely nervous because there was pictures of him winning the title. There was pictures of him wearing the Mankind mask, the Dude Love outfit, the Cactus Jack outfit. There was all this stuff. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm about to meet somebody that I have grown up watching since I was a kid. Literally since I was 8 years old, I grew up watching this man, and I'm about to meet him. Yep. And you get nervous. You're thinking, what if they're not nice?
Exactly.
But he was. He was nothing but nice. It was really cool. And it was really, what I liked about meeting Mick Foley is that he looked you directly in the eyes and talked to you like a human being.
He didn't. And I found that a lot of them will like look through you or they're looking at the surroundings. But when Adam would talk, Mick was looking at Adam. When I would talk, Mick was looking at me. And he made sure that we both felt like we equally got, you know, Mick Foley attention that day, I think.
We did. We got Mick Foley attention. And he did that not just for us, but for everybody that came to his booth. The way he just interacted with his fans, there's no wonder why he is where he's at today.
Why he's one of the greatest.
Because he's just that good of a person. And it was awesome. We got his, not only did we get a picture, but we got his autograph. Off the Cuff's first autograph signed picture. He made the photo out to Off the Cuff.
Yep.
And if I had the photo here, I would show it to those who are watching on Facebook Live. But it was really cool to meet him. It made me start thinking, though, when we got his autograph, Amber, why is it even a thing that we get people's autograph?
I wish I could tell you that, because that's perplexed me my entire life. I love it. Don't get me wrong. You've seen how many I have. I love collecting them. But when I go to, like, you know, store them or put them in something, I always think, why do I have this?
It's a signature. So why do we get so tore up over getting somebody's signature? You would think a picture would be more prevalent than,
exactly,
than,
well,
a,
I think in this generation a photo is more prevalent, but I think in prior generations where, you know, we weren't constantly carrying around cameras, that's probably why people, you know, they wanted to be like, I met so-and-so, but
yeah,
it was like, that's just a signature. No, you could have done that yourself,
right,
at the house.
People aren't going up to people anymore these days if they see them on the street saying, can I have your autograph? What,
yeah,
do they say? They say,
can I take a selfie?
Can I get a photo with you? And that's, do you think that, I'll do you one further. It's easy to say that a photo is the new autograph, but my friend Chad brought this up one day to me. He asked me this. He said, is getting a mention on Twitter the equivalent of an autograph today? Think about it. If there, we both know this guy who's a wrestling fan, and he tweeted The Rock.
Yep.
The Rock tweeted our friend back and wrote him a message. So if my friend was to screenshot that official tweet that he sent him from his verified account, wouldn't that be an electronical version of, and it would be equivalent to an autograph today?
That's 20 times better than an actual autograph.
It is, because it's more, because you got to think,
personal.
You got to think, an autograph was just them signing their name.
They didn't care. They were just like, okay, you want me to sign my name, okay.
But if a celebrity writes you on Twitter, you've got something better than an autograph.
You do.
So you need to screenshot that.
And in all honesty, you got something better than a picture. You've got a personalized message that was to you.
Very true. Very true. I think the picture trumps the mention of on Twitter, but I see what you mean, because they're actually conversing with you electronically through a cell phone, and it's more than just signing their name.
Yep. They actually read what you wrote, and they actually gave you like a genuine response, not the, oh, thank you so much for watching my movies.
The Scarefest, it was crowded, and when you have a lot of crowds, you have sometimes rude people. Something that really irritates me, just to get on a little irritated kick here, I don't want to sit here and tell you all the things that irritate me, because we'd be here for the entire hour, but I hate it when I'm in a crowd, and let's say we're both trying to get past each other.
Okay.
Me and a total stranger, and we're trying to walk past each other. Sometimes, what do you say? I'll say, excuse me.
Yep.
I hate it before I can even excuse myself. Somebody will look at me and say, excuse you.
And it's like, who gave you the authority to be the one to excuse me?
And I'm like, what? And it throws me off guard. I'm like, instead of them saying, excuse me, they say, excuse you. Excuse you? Like, you're saying, you're telling me I need to be excused, but when you're trying to get past me, just like I'm trying to get past you, I hate that. Do you ever have anybody say that to you? Or have you?
I mean, I'm sure I have.
Oh, that runs all over me.
I'm sure I have.
Or when you're holding the door open for somebody and they don't
say and they don't back. Say anything. You know that that is probably in, it's probably in my top three things of things that just absolutely drive me bananas. Number one being, okay, if you walk up to someone, I'm not saying that you have to know them the best, you know, someone that you casually know, and you say hello, and they reply, mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, don't say anything back. They just give you a mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Or when you, I'll make people say hello to me.
Oh, I don't. Like, I...
Oh, I do.
I shut down. Don't ask me anything.
No.
Don't look at me.
No.
I will slam the door in your face.
If I say hello to you and you do not say hi back, I will make you say... I used to work with this woman. I used to work with her. And I said hello to her in the morning times. I would say good morning. And she would not speak. She would not say anything back. She would just kind of look at me. And I would think, oh, maybe she didn't hear me. So I would say, hey, how's it going? She would just put her head down. And I was like, how rude is that? We'd be passing each other in the parking lot. She would be getting back from lunch, and I would be going to lunch.
Uh-huh.
And I'd say, hey. And she wouldn't say anything. She wouldn't say anything. I mean, even if somebody just smiles at you, that's still not what you're supposed to do.
No.
If somebody speaks to you, speak back.
Exactly. Just say hello. Even if you don't want to talk, there's so many times that, you know, you do it to me all the time. I'll be like, hey. You'll be like, hey, and keep walking.
Right.
You know, just say hello and keep going. You know, it just common courtesy. It goes a long way, guys.
Yes.
It goes a long way.
Common courtesy. Don't be rude. It goes a long way. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we got to take a quick commercial break, and we will be right back after these words. I gotta get better with the shelter in. Let's see what's on the shelter in.
Not too much right now.
There's nothing more important than staying up to date before, during, and after emergencies. That's why it's important to sign up for LexAlert and emergency management. You'll get emergency alerts on your cell phone with a call or a text. If you prefer, you'll just get an email to your phone, tablet, or computer. When seconds count, get your best alerts from LexAlerts. Sign up for LexAlerts today at BeReadyLexington.com. We'll be glad you did.
Newspaper El Mundo Bluegrass is proud to support Lexington Community Radio. El Mundo Bluegrass is a Spanish language newspaper. Free. American community with news from KOR centers in the world. The Bluegrass World can be found at stores and businesses, Mexicans, Latinas, or Americans. For publicity or more information, visit www.elmundobluegrass.com and follow us on Facebook at Mundo Bluegrass or call today at 859-270-8083.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in the studio with me.
That's some good music.
It is a good music. We're not playing that for a throwback. That music is played at UK football games, which I think they need to change it because it is an old song. It is a good song.
It's a good one.
But we need to change some things with the football games because we kind of get used to doing things and we don't stop doing things and it gets a little old. For instance, when I'm at a UK football game, if I hear, first down Kentucky, one more time, I'm going to scream. I get it. We're excited that Kentucky has a first down. But can we please say something else? I mean,
well,
seriously.
What would you suggest they say?
I mean, I don't know, but just something different. I mean, something different.
We should start a poll.
So, what else could we say?
Yeah, what else could we say?
What else could Carl Nathy say when the Cats get a touchdown? But it was a big game last weekend, so I want to talk about it, Kentucky versus Florida. But before I talk about the game, let me just say I was really put back into reality with my seats. So when I went and watched the Eastern Michigan game, I sat in the Woodford Reserve rich seats. Florida Not so much. I was slapped back into reality.
Were you back in the Adam Banks from Lexington City?
I was back. It was back at the
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I was back in my seats. So I got kicked in the back a couple times by a few kids.
No peanuts in your hair.
No peanuts in my hair, thank God. Because there's a way to avoid that. Now they did put back. What do you call the bleachers? They have backs to them now.
Oh, like seat backs.
They all have backs to them.
Okay.
They all have backs to them. And I, of course, had to pay $6-7 for a box of M&M's.
Okay.
Which is ridiculous. That needs to be changed.
Is that all you got, was just M&M's?
Yeah, I got M&M's, and I got a soda, and what else did
I
get?
I'm not impressed with their soda. I think we physically talked about this when we were at our game that we went to last year.
Yeah.
I was not impressed. Was it flat? Because it was flat when I got mine.
It wasn't worth $7.
Okay.
And I got popcorn. So, that right there, what was that, $35?
I was going to say, did you have to
get a
mortgage?
That's price gouging. That needs to be changed. I mean, seriously, it's a place where people are bringing their families, and you got to think about these people who are bringing their families. They're not just going and buying them a...
No.
Thing of popcorn and a pop. They got to buy mommy one, bubby one, sissy one. They got to buy all these people... food. So they're out $100 just on concession. But I got one better for you, Amber. So after the game, and I promise you I'll get to the game in a second, but after the game, I took an Uber home.
Okay.
Because I Ubered to the game.
Okay.
It was a great experience. It was only $20 to go to the game. What does parking typically cost?
$20, $25, according to where you are.
$20, $25. Uber's great. You pay $20, they drop you off at the door. Well, on the way back, what happened was what I thought was going to happen. It was horrible. I was afraid that I wasn't going to be able to get an Uber home because there's 50,000 other people trying to get out of the stadium, and
yep.
A lot of the times Uber won't mess with it. So I walked a little bit away from the stadium, actually a long way from the stadium. On Nicholasville Road, I walked from Kroger Field to the U.S. Bank on Nicholasville Road. Just to get out of the area so I could Uber. Yeah.
Wow. A 3-mile walk.
Probably. Well, still yet, Uber, you know how much I paid to get home? 5 miles.
Probably $35, $40.
Up. Keep guessing.
Let's do $75.
Up. Keep guessing.
You're lying.
No, I'm not. It was $85.
Did you not just call me?
I thought about it, but I want to save you. I like keeping you in my back pocket just in case I really, really, like, am in a place where I do
I
need you.
I think walking 3 miles and spending $85 on a ride home, you could have pulled that car.
Isn't that stupid, though? $85, it cost me, that costs more than my tickets.
I didn't even pay $85 in a cab going around New York this year.
That would, $85 would have put me probably on the field to watch UK football.
Yes.
And I paid that just to get home, but I had to. And it's stupid that Uber does that. Uber does that all the time. Uber, when they know that they have really busy rate.
What, or peak or something
peak
like that.
Time. But that's ridiculous. I can see it going up to $30, $40, but $80, come on.
By the time you go and you spend $35 buying, and it really, honestly, was probably $35 what you bought, and then you have to pay $85 for an Uber, does that not make you just want to completely just never go to an event ever again?
Well, yeah, I think that's why a lot of people are not going to events, because why would you? You can sit at home on your nice comfy couch.
Eat you a pizza from Papa John's.
Flat screen TV.
Drink you a beer.
High definition. Drink you a beer. All the beer you want.
And
all the snacks you want.
I cannot wait to ask you about this. I've been waiting.
Yeah.
How did it feel to go back to using normal people bathroom?
It was, like I said, I was very quickly reminded that I was back into reality. Thank God that they got rid of the troughs at Kroger Field. We've talked about this on the show before, but they did used to have troughs at Kroger Field.
It's just a concept that as a female, I cannot grasp.
Men need more privacy in the bathrooms. At least, I hate it when they just assume that men don't need privacy in the bathroom.
I agree with that.
Ain't that horrible?
There is no way I would ever just walk into a bathroom and just let a stranger, like, see me in, you know, in my birthday suit.
Amber, they've got urinals on the wall with no dividers.
No.
Yeah, that's not right. They don't need to do that. So,
I'd be like, well, this ain't an anatomy class. let's get some dividers.
But the game itself, I said last week, the talk of the game, it was going to be all about Sawyer Smith. Well, Sawyer Smith, the new quarterback for Kentucky, since Terry Wilson went down. He finished 21 for 28 for 251 yards and two touchdown passes with three picks in his first start as a Wildcat. Pretty good. I give him A-minus for this game because of the way he played his first game, the pressure, playing Florida as a starter for the first time. Hey, I give him props for that. So after leading much of the game, though, Kentucky led most of the game. I've said this before. Kentucky won everything except the scoreboard in that game. But for leading most of the game, Kentucky ended up losing. Okay? They ended up losing. And we're not going to be going streaking. So the two-game winning streak is not going to happen. And the Gators defeated the Cats 29-21 after holding them scoreless over the final 20 minutes and 39 seconds. UK's last five drives ended in a failed fourth down conversion, a punt, and an interception, a 35-yard field goal attempt missed by redshirt freshman Chance Poor. We missed a field goal that should have been made and could have easily been made. 35 yards, okay? Yeah. That's only 15 or 20 yards longer than the extra point.
Yeah.
So if you are playing college football and you can't make a 35-yard kick, you don't need to be playing college football. Okay, Chance? And I get it. He's a kid, so I'm going to be easy on him, and I'm not going to be an idiot and tweet him like a lot of people have been.
Oh,
stop
no.
it. A lot of people... He's a kid. Stop tweeting this young man that he's horrible.
He's 18, but you know what? He's not that horrible, because look where he's playing. You know, I don't see these people on, you know, college leagues.
I mean, I'm not going to sit here and say he's not horrible. Coming off of a game where he missed a 35-yard kick that should have been made. But to make him feel better, if this does make him feel better, if he would have made the kick, Kentucky wouldn't have won anyway, because the Gators outscored Kentucky 19-0 in the final quarter. And also something else that was really strange is Florida's quarterback got hurt in the game,
mm-hmm.
and the backup quarterback came in,
uh-huh.
and my friend that I was with at the game, he said, uh-oh, and I said, what? He said, we always get beat by a backup quarterback, and guess what?
He came
in there, and he balled out. I mean, like, he was Tim Tebow out there. It was like Tim Tebow came back and suited up for the Gators, and I couldn't believe that. Big fan of Smoke, Cavassier Smoke, just because I like his name. We need more Smoke. Then, who's the running back for Kentucky? A.J. Rose?
Sure.
Yeah. AJ, we need more Smoke than we need Rose. I'll tell you that. Because that guy is great.
I'll have to take your word on that.
And it's not just because his name is Smoke. But anyway, that was the Florida-Kentucky game. We got to look ahead. Next weekend, or this Saturday, it's Kentucky at Mississippi State. So it's our first road game. It's at 4 p.m. on the SEC Network, or it could be on the SEC Alternate. And if you're a bettor, like I am, the bet right now, the line is Kentucky +6, Mississippi State -6, and the over-under is 48.5. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take another commercial break, and we will be right back after these words. Stick with us.
That was hard. I held that in.
You did? Oh, you held the cough in?
Yeah.
Bluegrass Cycling Club reminds you bicycles are considered vehicles under Kentucky law and have the same rights and responsibilities as motorists. Cyclists, stay alert and make eye contact with motorists on the road with you. Motorist, by law, you must share the road with cyclists. Make sure to make eye contact, use your turn signals, and leave at least 3 feet when passing. Drive safely, ride safely, and share the road left.
I have to ask you a question. What's this word?
Did you miss your favorite show on Lexington Community Radio? Maybe you're looking for something new to listen to. Now, Lexington Community Radio
is that what that word is?
Barbituate.
Not, not barbitch.
No.
Barbituate.
Community-radio to see all the shows available.
Barbituate.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in the studio with me. Unfortunately, very sad news happened this past week. Eddie Money, who is the singer of this song, probably his most notable song.
Oh, no.
You don't think so? More than this?
No.
Okay, before we start, though, I just don't want you to be throwing out random songs that nobody's ever heard of. Are people going to be able to understand?
Baby Hold On, I think, is probably one of his biggest ones.
See, I don't know what that is.
Baby Hold On to Me.
Nope. Oh, well, yeah. But not more than this.
Okay.
I started reading about Eddie Money, and I found that he's a very, very interesting man. So, I'm going to tell you some things that I read about him that I just found wild. So, he apparently, after drinking a lot of vodka, he overdosed on a synthetic barbiturate drug that he mistook for cocaine. He thought he was about to snort cocaine. Instead, he did this synthetic drug
that
he thought was cocaine, and it damaged his sciatic nerve on his left leg, and it left him unable to walk for months, and then after that, he had a permanent limp thereafter. So that explains why he always walked with a limp.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
In 2001, he joined a 12-step program to deal with his drinking and made a promise to his wife and children that he would change. In 2003, he reported that he was clean and sober. So that was great. And in July 2019, Money underwent heart valve surgery and contracted pneumonia, causing him to cancel tour dates, and he had been a smoker for years, and he was ended up being diagnosed with stage 4 esophageal cancer, and complications from the cancer resulted ultimately in his death. He died in Los Angeles Hospital on September 13th, 2019, at the age of 70. But man, another artist.
So young.
It sounds so young. Another artist gone.
That just, you know, I enjoyed Eddie Money. I guess that's why I was a little critical of you, you know, in the beginning. And also, Take Me Home Tonight was probably...
Take me home
yeah, that's,
tonight.
That's my second.
Yes, that's a good one.
The biggest, my husband and I, we have a joke that I love to tell him. I'll look at him and I'll say, why does Eddie Money make a terrible travel agent? And he always tells me, we've only got 2 tickets. And I say, where are they going? And he says, Paradise. And I say, when's it leaving? He said, tonight. So that honestly has been a running joke at our house for probably the last couple of years. So don't think I'll be able to use that one anymore.
But another legend gone in the music world. Okay, I want to talk about this, Amber, because it's been trending all over social media. It's everywhere, over news outlets. Vaping.
Okay.
Vaping, vaping, vaping. Everybody is seeing these stories on vaping. People getting put in the hospital for apparent lung damage due to vaping. So the CDC suspects chemical exposure is what is causing people to have damage to their lungs. But experts have not yet identified a specific agent as the culprit. So there's not really been a link. They've narrowed it down to THC products. So vapes, I don't know if you know this, but you can not only vape tobacco products, you can also vape THC products.
Okay.
And if you do that, apparently they're saying not to vape at all right now, but they're saying that people are getting this exposure from those THC cartridges.
Well, okay, there's a couple of things that go into it. I love the Facebook warriors when they get on there and they, you know, are constantly reposting things, and they don't do any type of factual checking. But, you know, when you look at some of the things that people have been talking about, Legionnaires' disease has been thrown out there as one of the, you know, complications that people are having, which the biggest thing that you need to take away from it is the vape juice. I don't like saying it like that, but your juice, whatever have you, whether it be no nicotine, nicotine, THC, the ones that we're seeing that are causing these problems are ones that are being created in people's garages.
Mm-hmm.
So would you go to some random dude's house and eat chicken that he made you? Probably not. Like, you probably wouldn't.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
But think about it, right, because this has come out of nowhere. Vaping is not new.
No, it's not a new concept.
People have been vaping for years. Yes, the popularity has grown beyond belief. But vaping is not a new phenomenon.
No.
But this new lung damage thing is. So, I don't know what this is, Amber. I don't know if it's the government I'm going to be one of these people right now. Sometimes I think the government likes to put their nose in places when they think that's, when it's affecting things that they don't want it to affect.
Exactly.
For instance, all of a sudden now they're talking about it being THC cartridges. Here we go again. Here they are hating on THC.
It ain't got nothing to do with that.
We know the health benefits that people are constantly saying they have from THC. Nothing medically documented before I get a million calls. But everybody's saying how good they feel after they, with their pain and their sleep, insomnia, all that after THC. Here we go again. The government's trying to stick their nose into things and saying, don't vape now because apparently it's in THC cartridges. There is this theory called the agenda setting theory. And it was developed by Max McCombs and Donald Shaw. The theory suggests that the media has a great influence to their audience by instilling what they should think instead of what they think. That is, if a news item is covered frequently and prominently, the audience will regard the issue as more important. That's what we got going on here.
I agree with that.
Oh, it is. The media controls our thoughts.
I just love that, you know, as a whole, people get entirely upset about things. Yes, there are a couple of people who have lost their lives, and I think that's very, very, very unfortunate. But why are we, like, why all of a sudden has gun violence become something that we're not talking about? And now vaping is a new thing that we need to, you know, we need to jump on that bandwagon. We need to talk about vaping. Who cares, you know, about school shootings and children being shot? Who doesn't? We don't care about that right now. We need to talk about vaping because that's what's trending on Facebook. That's what I think bothers me the most about this is people are so open arms about it, but it's really... Look at what you're getting. You're getting products that are being made in somebody's garage, whether it be, you know, undermarket, aftermarket, anything like that. Like, I don't know. I don't know what people expect.
A new generation is getting hooked on nicotine is the problem, is what people, is and the government is trying to find a way to manipulate and influence people's thinking by saying, okay, because that's the problem. Because it is what it is. People that vape, they've got, it's got nicotine in it. It's easily addictive. So the government's like, gosh, we don't want this new generation getting addicted to nicotine. Let's just talk about all these health scares. Now, of course, this is all theory, and yeah. this is all my theory, a conspiracy theory.
But I love a conspiracy theory.
I do too. But it is strange that just all of a sudden people are in the hospital with lung damage. I mean, I'm talking severe lung damage because they've scared everybody to death. They have scared everybody who vapes to death over all of this news coming out about people with lung damage in the hospital. And there's a reason for it. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's THC. I don't know if it's if they actually care about this new generation. But and Donald Trump, here he goes and he bans. I mean, goes and bans flavored nicotine.
Yes.
Flavored nicotine juices.
And you know, there were actually a few legit businesses here in Lexington that were affected or are going to be affected by this ban. And you know, I actually did take the time to read that. You know,
yeah.
we have a problem. We do have a problem. Yeah. I won't say, and I shouldn't have overshadowed it earlier. We do have a problem. But if we're just going around and saying, okay, well, it's all these flavored ones, get rid of them, and then people still keep getting sick, what are we going to do now?
Yeah. And here's the thing. If he banned all these flavored to products, people are now going to even more go to the black market to
yes.
get these flavored products, which is obviously where it's originating from because it was fine before 3 months ago.
Yep.
Just 3 months ago, you never heard anything like this, but now it's all over the place. And this is people's livelihood. People have businesses, vape shops that they feed their families with, and a lot of them are being... I bet you sales have went dramatically down in the vape industry.
I would say, and you know, and the only thing that's going to accomplish, and I really hope you agree with me on this, is vape sales are going to go down. Guess what? Sales are going to go up.
Cigarettes.
People are going to go right back to cigarettes.
Exactly. And we have come so far. We have come so far with getting rid of the cigarettes and tossing the cigarettes. I hope we don't take steps back. But ladies and gentlemen, it is time for Off the Cuff Song of the Week. And Amber, I am very excited to play this Song of the Week. I've been obsessed with this song.
Okay.
I have been, I don't know why either. Have you ever just, you listen to a song and you're like, I don't know why I like this song.
That's but, every song I hear.
But I love it. And it's given another female love
okay.
for the Song of the Week. So this song is called Dance Monkey by Tones and I. So, ladies and gentlemen, roll down them windows and enjoy Off the Cuff's Song of the Week. I wanted to get that song in there because if I didn't get my song in there, hey, Jim.
This isn't the girl that has two color hair, is it?
Maybe.
Prince of like a baby doll.
Tones and eye.
I don't like the look.
Lock it.
No.
No.
She's got a weird voice.
Thank you. Is this Bobby and Marie? Is this just Bobby? Is this just Marie? Who is this? Well, tell me, how's everybody doing? Charlie, Bobby, Boo, Justin. Brett, Brittany,
Tiffany,
how are they all doing? Well, how's the kids? And apparently, I was told. Yes. Okay, so, sorry. I don't know what was going on there with the technical difficulties. It was my headphones. I was, like, talking, and I was like, am I even on the air? What's going on here? Jeez.
You love these headphones, but they cause so much drama.
Yeah, I don't know what the issue was there. Sorry about that, folks. Before I go to a commercial break, people have been writing me. They're like, what are the symptoms to this vaping disorder? The only thing that I can tell you is if you feel any pain in your chest and you have, and you have difficulty breathing, then you probably should seek immediate medical attention. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we got one more commercial break to take, so stick with us, and we will be right back after these words. I had my headphones turned off, and I thought I wasn't on the air. I was like, bitch, you could hear me?
Yeah.
Hey, this is Lane with Life
and Tune in on Fridays from 1 to 2 p.m. as we play upbeat music. I just had a lot of difficulties with this chair over here.
what's happening around you.
KET's new documentary, Big Family, The Story of Bluegrass Music, explores this musical genre with footage from around the world and interviews with legends and newcomers alike. Narrated by actor and bluegrass enthusiast Ed Helms, this film features more than 50
Thank
musicians.
You.
The National
You look very professional.
Do I? That's what
yeah.
I was going for. I look like I work for UK Media.
Like you're officiating, maybe. Not officiating, but like... You own something, Alexa. There we go.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Like I should be sitting.
Like you should be sitting in the Woodford Club. Not using troughs.
Yes. And alerts from the health department and information about emergencies.
Not using troughs.
Like evacuation.
Good. Everybody's doing good. Good deal.
Exactly.
Tell everybody I said hello.
It is just like cleaning your room.
Mom.
There's nothing more important. Staying up to date before, during, and after emergencies. That's why it's important to sign up for Lex Alerts from Lexington Emergency Management. You'll get emergency alerts on your cell phone with a call or a text. If you'd prefer, you'll just get an email to your phone, tablet, or computer. When seconds count, get your best alerts from Lex Alerts. Sign up for Lex Alerts today at BeReadyLexington.com. You'll be glad you did.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Last segment of the hour, Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in the studio with me. If you do not recognize this music, this is the Zach Attack. Zach Morris, Kelly Kapowski, AC Slater, Samuel Screech Powers singing Friends Forever.
You forgot Lisa Turtle.
Lisa Turtle was in there. I knew there was some that wasn't in the Zach Attack.
I think it was just Jesse Spano. Jesse Spano was not in the Zach Attack.
No. Well,
she had her singing debut when she was dressed up like Cleopatra singing,
yeah.
You know.
So I think they all were in the Zach Attack, but for some reason,
she wasn't doing the tour.
No.
She was in Vegas dancing on the pole.
Yes. For showgirls. The reason I play this, ladies and gentlemen, is if you're a 90s kid, you got to be excited because they have announced that there will be a Saved by the Bell remake/reboot. And apparently it is coming to NBC's new streaming service called The Peacock. And it's free for those who have cable. And they are coming out with original content. And one of the original shows that they want to produce on this new streaming service is the Saved by the Bell remake. And I got so excited when I saw this because it's just anything to do with nostalgia I love. But I have concerns, I have questions, and I have thoughts on everything going on with this reboot. I am all for it if it's done right. I don't know if anyone watched 90210 back in the day, but they come out with a reboot here in the 2000s, in this decade, and I think I really like what they're doing with that reboot. It's kind of a show within a show where their real-life characters in the show are playing the characters from the old show.
Yeah.
If that makes any sense.
Yeah.
So, for instance, like if Saved by the Bell was to do this, it would be Mark Paul Gosselaar in the show playing his character Zach Morris in the show. And Tiffany Amber Thiessen in the show would also be playing Kelly Kapowski. So they're essentially playing two characters in the show, themselves and the character in the show. I really liked that, what they did there. I don't know if they'll go that way. I don't know what way they're going. But I hope it's good. So far, the only people to have been attached to this project is AC Slater, Mario Lopez, and Jesse Spano.
Elizabeth Berkley.
And AC Slater, I need to call him
Mario.
Mario is supposedly supposed to be the producer. He got a deal with his new contract that he is supposed to produce original content for NBC, and so that's what he's going to do. And Saved by the Bell is a project. But I read some things that I didn't like. One being, Mark Paul Gosselaar is not attached to the show yet.
Well, Mark is actually going to be on a new show called Mixed-ish.
Yeah.
I think it is coming to ABC, actually. So maybe, you know, he's tied up with another project right now.
You would think that, but see, Mark Paul Gosselaar, and I quote, he says, "I read it in the trades just like everybody else in the morning." He said that, honestly, I was never approached. I haven't been approached, and I woke up to the news this morning with a huh kind of response. He said, "I absolutely would love to do a reboot if the if I felt the material was validated." He said, "The last thing I'd want to do is tarnish the product that we've created." So I think that was a very great response. But what gets me is he had no idea.
Well, I mean, okay, so there's a couple of things that we know just because we are frequent followers of Mark Paul. I wonder if maybe some of it had to do with, you know, he did have a show that got canceled recently. He did remove himself from social media. I just wonder if he removed himself entirely, you know, just took a step back, and maybe they didn't feel comfortable, you know, talking to him about it, because he honestly doesn't put out the best vibe when he talks about Saved by the Bell.
He don't. We've met Mark Paul before. Both of us have. And when we met him, he was very, don't get me wrong, he was very cool, had a very calm spirit about him, very chill. But when we spoke to him, Amber, he seemed very, we talked about Saved by the Bell with him, but he seemed like he didn't want to talk about it at all.
No, he was very much promoting his new show, which I get that. That's what you're getting paid by now. So yeah. I got that, you know. And I do have to agree, he was definitely a nice celebrity to meet, but he was not one of the most personable people that I've ever met. He was very standoffish. I think our interaction with him was maybe like 30, 40 seconds.
And and Mark Paul, look, you are not that famous enough to be acting like that anymore.
No, you've got Mick Foley, who spent 10 minutes with us, you know, taking pictures. You know, if you guys want to see them, we've got them up on our social media, but we've got pictures, you know, with Mick Foley, and we've got one photo with Mark Paul Gosselaar, and it's very staged.
But the fact that he says that he wasn't notified, he didn't know about it, tells me two things. One, he's lying, because
we've established that on the podcast that we done. We asked him about particular things, you know, during Saved by the Bell, and he was very like, "Oh, I don't remember that."
Yeah, he says
I don't remember any of that.
How do you not remember?
You remember that.
Mick Foley has had more brain damage and has been smashed in the head with a steel chair more than I have dropped or spilt my water, which is a lot.
Which is a lot.
So that's stupid, Mark Paul, that you say that you can't remember an episode. And I could see if he didn't remember certain scenes, but he's acting like he don't remember significant episodes.
He didn't remember anything.
He didn't even remember the drunk driving episode.
The only thing he wanted to talk about was he did enjoy like the made-for-TV movies that they made when they went to Hawaii or they went to Palm Springs. That was it.
Yeah, so it tells me two things. One, he is lying. And two, it tells me that Mario Lopez intentionally didn't tell Mark Paul because Mario wants to be the star of this reboot.
Well,
and he's the producer, and he doesn't want to attach Mark Paul to the project because, let's be honest, once he does that, it is going to be all about Mark Paul Gosselaar.
It will.
Because the show is Zach and Kelly. You can't have Saved by the Bell without Zach and Kelly, especially Zach. So if the reboot happens and Mark Paul Gosselaar is not attached to the project, it's going to be a disaster.
Do you think it's too late for us to submit our idea that we came up with?
We've talked about it before. Do you want to talk about it on the radio?
Of course I do. Like, okay. That's why I brought it up.
Yeah, let's just go ahead and we're going to tell our idea for what we think the Saved by the Bell reboot should be. I think if it's going to be completely scripted and they're not going to do what 90210 did and add the real life characters into the show, I think what would be really cool for Saved by the Bell to do is to give it kind of a Shameless vibe.
Yep.
Shameless, the TV show from Showtime. Make it very kind of raunchy.
And real life. Make it real life.
And the reason I say that is because your audience is now grown up.
Yep.
The Saved by the Bell audience is no longer the same kids that was watching it in the late 80s, early 90s on Saturday morning. We're all older now. We're all in our 30s. We're all in our 40s. And those are the people that you need to start appealing to. So you need to come up with content. When you remake Saved by the Bell, please don't make it corny and childish because it will fail after two or three episodes.
If Mr. Belding does that laugh, like at 10, that was cool. At 31, that's not cool.
Yeah, they need to do some things different with this Saved by the Bell. I mean, they need to make it a little bit raunchy. So we had a plan. Keep in mind the shameless vibe. So Zach's going to be the principal.
The principal.
Kelly is going to be his wife, and she's going to be...
like a social studies teacher, I think is what we picked.
Social studies teacher. Jessie is going to be a lesbian, and she's going to be the security guard of the school of Bayside. And because...
Did we say Tori?
No, it was... Tori's just going to come in there every now and then. Okay. It would make so much sense if Jessie was a lesbian. It would. And Lisa... is going to be, is she the home ec teacher?
I thought she was a doctor, but she was on the board.
Okay, yeah.
Because
okay.
We wanted to keep her elevated.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was on the board. She was maybe on the board of regents.
Yeah.
Screech, maybe the science teacher.
Or he on the max.
Or on the max. Or we could have somebody else do something where they on the max. Maybe that's a good way to bring another character back.
We could maybe put Belding there. Or Belding could be the mentor to Zach Morris.
Or the superintendent.
True.
Yeah.
And then Mario was going to be the gym teacher.
But there you go, Hollywood. We just gave it. So here is what the synopsis is right now that was released from NBC. It says, when California Governor Zach Morris... Time out. Zach Morris is the governor? Time in. Gets into hot water for closing too many low-income high schools. He proposes they send the affected students to the highest-performing schools in the state, including Bayside High. The influx of new students gives the overprivileged Bayside kids a much-needed and hilarious dose of reality.
That does not sound appealing to me at all.
So, NBC's streaming service, The Peacock, is set to launch next April, with originals joining the lineup in summer 2020.
I am not, like, and, you know, we're huge Saved by the Bell fans, and I'm not impressed with that. I really hope that it takes a different route.
I do, too.
And I really hope, you know, they've got to reach out to Dustin Diamond.
They do. I think in order for a remake or a reboot, a revival, whatever the heck you want to call it, in order for it to truly work, you got to bring back the original cast. You can't leave one out, then another one out, then another. You've got to bring everybody back.
I feel like they're being very, like, mean girlish. Because, you know, they
towards
left...
Dustin.
Well, not even just towards Dustin, but, you know, they left Dustin and Lark out of the Jimmy Fallon, you know, when they done that whole little, you know, get back together thing. They left them out. They left Dustin out of a lot of things, which I understand. I'd leave him out, too. You know, he's kind of a jerk.
They're not doing what's best for business.
They're not.
Sometimes you got to do what's best for business. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for listening to another episode of Off the Cuff. You can follow Off the Cuff on Facebook at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You can follow me on Twitter at AdamBanks88. Follow me on Instagram at AdamBanks818. I'll be on Midday Kentucky Monday and Tuesday on ABC 36 at 12:30 if you want to check that out as well. You can follow Amber on Instagram and Snapchat at Ambu_447. Covered a lot.
We did.
Covered a lot. It's been a good show.
It's always a good show.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is Amber Turner, I'm Adam Banks, and this is Off the Cuff. We'll see you next Thursday from 4 to 5. Have a great week. All right. Thank you, everybody, for watching. Appreciate it. See you in the next episode.